It's good to be with you this morning as we study together from the Word of God. We'll be looking at Acts chapter 7 this morning, so if you want to turn your Bibles there, you may. We need to review just a bit to sort of set the stage for what we're going to get. In the last chapter, some men from the synagogue of the freedmen secretly induced some folks to say, "We have heard Stephen speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God." And so, again, he's sort of on trial. They drag him away, and they bring him before the Sanhedrin. False witnesses accused him of speaking against this holy place, probably both the land and the temple, and the law. And that will be important. They claimed that he said that Jesus would destroy the temple and alter the customs handed down by Moses. Now, again, they're misinterpreting something Jesus said. He said, "Destroy this temple and in 3 days I'll raise it up again," talking about his own body. But they're taking it to be literally the temple, and they're saying that Jesus made those claims and good old Stephen is standing with him. The charges are as follows. Number one, he speaks against this holy place, namely the land. So he speaks against the land. He speaks against the law. He says you don't have to keep the law. He doesn't say that, but they say he does. And he said that this Nazarene Jesus will destroy this place, that is the temple. And so he's speaking against the temple. And finally, he seeks to alter the customs which Moses handed down to us. The sermon is going to be interesting. It's a three-point sermon. It's interesting how many sermons preachers preach that have 3 points. It is the land, the law, and the temple. And he's going to work through those issues and say, those are not, you folks are misinterpreting it, and you don't understand your Old Testament very well, and so you're misunderstanding what's happening here. So let's work at the text. We begin in verse 1. The high priest said, "Are these things so?" The accusations they made in the last chapter. And he said, "Hear me, brethren and fathers. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran, and said to him, 'Leave your country and your relatives and come into the land that I will show you.' And then he left the land of the Chaldeans and settled in Haran. And from there, after his father died, God had him to move to this country in which you are now living. But he gave him no inheritance in it, not even a foot of ground. Yet, even when he had no child, he promised that he would give it to him as a possession and to his descendants after him." So he's going to begin with his defense, his apology. By the way, the word apology, we get our word apologetics from that word. The original word means a defense. It's not, "I stepped on your foot and I'm sorry I did it." It is an apology, a defense. To a degree, it's hardly a defense at all. It's not really designed to get an acquittal. He's not saying, you should let me go because. Some see it with little or no link to between the sermon and the accusations in the previous chapter. I don't think that's the case, though. I think he really is addressing those issues, and it's going to be those 3 points that I mentioned earlier. Stephen had a sermon, they say, that he wanted to preach, and so he did it, and so there's no real link. But really, it's going to be the accusations. Blasphemy against the land, the law, and the temple. And he's beginning with the land. The three-point sermon with the accusation against his accusers. Number one, on the land. The Jewish declaration of faith in the Old Testament always is the intervention of God in history. It's a kind of resume that he gives us of the history of Israel. And so he's going to tell us the Old Testament story in his sermon. And he begins with good old Abraham, and that's really who you would expect. But wherever God meets his people, that's going to be holy ground. You'll remember when we get a little later on, we get to Moses. Moses is on holy ground because that's where God is. But good old Abraham is going to be in the land of the Chaldeans, the Babylonians. He's going to be there in Ur of Chaldea when God first speaks to him. God doesn't speak to him in Israel. He speaks to him in Babylon. And so he makes a big deal of that. Dwelling in the promised land still requires a pilgrim lifestyle because this world is still not our home. Stephen argues against the veneration of the Holy Land. You got to leave room for God's redemptive work wherever man is, wherever the people of God are. And so he's going to be redeeming good old Abraham. It's not renouncing possession of the land. He's not saying possessing the land is bad or this land is a bad land. He's basically saying wherever God speaks to you, that's his intervention. And so he begins with the situation of good old Abraham. He's initially in Mesopotamia before he goes to Haran. Note he's outside the promised land. Both of those locations are outside the promised land. Although he entered the promised land, he didn't live as if he had arrived. He doesn't build a house there. He's always living in a tent. He owns no land there. The only piece of land that he will ultimately own is the place where he will bury his wife. He'll buy that piece of land, but that's it. The importance rests on the covenant and the relationship to God, and that's what really matters. There's some difficulties with chronology if you're reading along in his story and you're reading along in the Old Testament. There's some debate about how you're going to get these the right number of years. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 6, he says, you're going to spend 400 years in slavery. But if you're reading along in Exodus chapter 12, verse 40, it's 430 years. And so is there a real problem? One, maybe just a rounding off of the number and a literal count of the numbers. The importance rests in the covenant and in relationship to God. So here we go. There's my nice map. Notice at the far right hand of the map, you'll see Ur down at the bottom. And that's a long, long way away from Palestine. So there's Ur. And then he's going to move up to Haran. And Haran is up at the very top. If you're following that yellow line and you get to the peak of that yellow line, that's Haran. And that's where he's going to go with his father and his brother. And he's going to go that far initially. And then he'll be called to go into the land and he will move down. And you'll see Shechem down later, where he's going to spend a fair amount of time. But God spoke to this effect, that his descendants would be aliens in a foreign land, that they would be enslaved and mistreated 400 years. There's my 400 years, see it? And again, if you're reading in Exodus, it's literally 430 years. Whatever nation to which they will be in bondage, I myself will judge, said God, and after they will come and out and serve me in this place. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision. So Abraham became father of Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. And Isaac became the father of Jacob, and Jacob of the 12 patriarchs. And the patriarchs became jealous of Joseph and sold him into Egypt. Yet God was with him and rescued him from all his afflictions and granted him favor and wisdom in the sight of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. And he was made governor over Egypt and all his household. Now, a famine came over all Egypt and Canaan, and a great affliction with it, and our fathers could find no food. And when Jacob heard that there was grain in Egypt, he sent our fathers there for the first time. On the second visit, Joseph made himself known to his brothers, and Joseph's family was disclosed to Pharaoh. Then Joseph sent word and invited Jacob, his father, and all his relatives to come, 75 persons in all. And Jacob went down to Egypt. And there he and our fathers died. From there they would be removed to Shechem and laid in a tomb which Abraham had purchased with a sum of money from the sons of Hamor in Shechem. Interesting language. So we're going to get the story of good old Jacob now. We had Abraham and then Isaac and now Jacob. And we're going to get Jacob's story to start with. Notice they're going to spend time in Egypt. God is with them in Egypt. You don't have to be in the promised land to have God with you. God was with Abraham back in Mesopotamia, up in Haran, and in the promised land. And now the family's in Egypt. And he's going to be with them. The word, by the phrase, in Egypt will be used six times in verses 9 through 16. And so God's with them even in Egypt. Now, there's some difficulties again with the text. It says 75 went down to Egypt. In the Old Testament, you'll get 70. In the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, Genesis 46:27 has 75. And the issue is who do you count? If you count Joseph and his sons, Joseph, his sons, and his wife, you're going to get the 75. And so really there's not a contradiction there. It's just who do you count when you get it. Is it the 70 who came initially out of the land? Or do you count Joseph, since he comes out of the land as well, and then he has sons there? And then the burial grounds seem to be a bit confused as well. Abraham did purchase in Hebron a place called Machpelah, and Jacob's going to be buried, interestingly enough, at Shechem. At this time, as the time of the promise was approaching, which God had assured to Abraham, the people increased and multiplied in Egypt until there was another king over Egypt who knew nothing of Joseph. And when he who was took shrewd advantage of our race and mistreated our fathers so that they would expose their infants and they would not survive. It was at this time that Moses was born, and he was lovely in the sight of God, and he was nurtured 3 months in his father's home. And after he had been set outside, Pharaoh's daughter took him away and nurtured him as her own son. Moses was educated in all the learning of the Egyptians, and he was a man of power in words and deeds. So we now move to good old Moses. Again, notice Moses starts out not in the promised land, but in Egypt. And it's there that he's going to lead them from Egypt. But Moses is going to make a trek from Egypt to Arabia and then back to Egypt again. And then they'll be wandering in the wilderness for 40 years, and they don't get into the promised land till after Moses has died. But God is with them. So you're making this big deal about my saying bad things about the land. You need to understand God is with his people wherever they are. And it's always holy ground. God raises up a deliverer in Egypt. He provides Moses when he's in Midian. Midian, by the way, is modern-day Arabia. And so he's going to be in Midian working for his father-in-law and watching sheep there. And he'll be working as a shepherd there. He will see that burning bush, and God will speak to him in that burning bush. You remember that wonderful story. He commissions him at Mount Sinai. And again, Mount Sinai, it's not in the Sinai Peninsula. We've always assumed it's there. We have this wonderful map that always shows it there. That's not where Sinai is. Sinai is probably in Arabia. And so he's down in Arabia in Midian. And so it's there that God will speak to him. And he will indeed speak. There are miraculous events in Egypt and the Red Sea and the wilderness. God is with them. You see, even in Egypt, there are these wonderful miracles that occurred. You remember the terrible plagues, the 10 plagues, and God is in charge of all of that. And good old Moses will do some miracles, and they will cross the Red Sea on dry land, and then they'll be in the wilderness. And while they're in their wilderness, their clothes don't wear out, and God provides them with food to eat. God is with them even there, not in the promised land. So you folks are missing something. You don't understand what's happening, do you? But when he was approaching the age of 40, it entered into his mind to visit his brethren, the sons of Israel. And when he saw one of them being treated unjustly, he defended him and took vengeance up for the oppressed by striking down the Egyptian. And he supposed that his brethren understood that God was granting them deliverance through him. But they didn't understand. On the following day, he appeared to them as they were fighting together, and he tried to reconcile them in peace, saying, "Men, you are brethren. Why do you injure one another?" But the one who was injuring his neighbor pushed him away and saying, "You, who made you ruler and judge over us? You do not mean to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday, do you?" At this remark, Moses fled and became an alien in the land of Midian. And there he became the father of 2 sons. And after 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai in a flame of burning thorn bush. And when Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight. And as he approached to look more closely, there came a voice from the Lord. I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. Moses shook with fear and would not venture to look. But the Lord said to him, Take off your sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt and have heard their groans, and I have come down to rescue them. Come now, and I will send you to Egypt. Then Moses, whom they disowned, saying, Who made you a ruler and a judge, is the one whom God sent to be both ruler and deliverer with the help of an angel who appeared to him in the thorn bush. This man led them out, performing wonders and signs in the land of Egypt and in the Red Sea and in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to his sons, the sons of Israel, God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. This is the one who was in the congregation in the wilderness together with the angel who was speaking to him on Mount Sinai and who was with our fathers. He received living oracles to pass on to you. So God acts for His people in all places. He's acted for His people in Mesopotamia, in Haran, in Palestine, in Egypt, in Midian, at Mount Sinai, in Egypt again, at the Red Sea, and in the wilderness. God's with them wherever they are, isn't He? You folks have missed something. Shame on you. You think the land is so special. It's God who is special. And the fact that God is with you is what really matters. And so now He's going to deal with the part of it that becomes the law. Remember, they are arguing that He has said bad things about the land, the law, and the temple. And now He's going to talk about the law, on the law. He begins with a veneration of the law, because that's what the Jews would do. They would venerate the law. And a veneration of Moses. He is our great lawgiver. He's the hero of our nation. The accusation against Stephen, he's spoken against Moses in chapter 6, verse 11, and against the law in 6:13. And so he's now addressing that part of the accusation. Moses himself spoke of God raising up a prophet like me, verses 37 and 38. This in no way disparages Moses. That's not saying that Moses wasn't a great prophet and that he didn't speak for God. That's not saying that at all. But there's going to be a prophet like him that will arise. In fact, a prophet greater than he. Moses points beyond himself. And that prediction is in Deuteronomy 18, verses 15 through 18. Where he indeed sees it. Our fathers were willing to be obedient to him, that's Moses, but repudiated him in their hearts and turned back to Egypt, saying to Aaron, Make for us gods who will go before us. For this Moses who led us out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what happened to him. You'll remember he goes up to the mountain and he doesn't come down as soon as they expect him to come down. And so they're concerned about that. At that time, they made a calf and brought a sacrifice to the idol and were rejoicing in the works of their hands. But God turned away and delivered them up to serve a host of heaven. As it is written in the book of Moses, It was not to me that you offered victims and sacrifices 40 years in the... Was it not to me that you offered victims and sacrifices 40 years in the wilderness? Was it, O house of Israel? You also took along the tabernacle of Moloch and the star of the god of Rompha and the images that you made to worship. And I will send you into exile beyond Babylon. Our fathers had the tabernacle of testimony in the wilderness, just as it was he who spoke to Moses and directed him to make it according to the pattern which he had seen. And having received it in turn, our fathers brought it with Joshua upon possessing the nations whom God drove out before our fathers until the time of David. David found favor in God's sight and asked that he might find a dwelling place for the God of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built the house for him. However, the Most High does not dwell in houses made by human hands, as the prophet has said, Heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool, the footstool of my feet. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord, or what place is there for my repose? Was it not my hand which made all these things? So now he's going to move to that third part of the address. He's talked about the land, it's not so important. He's talked about the law and Moses giving the law, and now he moves to the temple. And you'll notice he begins by talking about the tabernacle. The emphasis on the tabernacle rather than the temple, I think, is the beginning point, because, you see, it symbolizes God's presence while they're wandering in the wilderness. That tabernacle, that special tent where they're going to worship. And so it's with our fathers during the wilderness wanderings. Wherever they go, they'll set up that tabernacle. It's central to Israel's life during the conquest, during the time that good old Joshua is leading them. And it's the focus up through the time of David. And it is, I think, there because of mobility. They need to move from place to place because they haven't settled in a single place yet. And ultimately, David's going to arrive at that place. He's going to make Jerusalem his capital city, and it will be in Jerusalem that the temple will be built. It will be Solomon, though, who builds the temple. It's really interesting. If you're reading that story in the Old Testament, you'll discover that David purchased a lot of the things that are going to go into the building of the temple and gathered them together as he's getting ready to build the temple, but it's Solomon who will build it. God will tell David, you've got blood on your hands, and you're not going to be the one who'll build this temple, but Solomon will. We almost see here a succession on God's point. God allows them to build it. The emphasis is on David's seed and the kingdom. And again, Jesus is going to be from the seed, from the line of David. The Most High does not live in a house made by men. It's really interesting. It's almost like God said, okay, if you think I need a temple, go ahead and build a temple. But I really don't need a temple because I don't live in a house made by man. I'm everywhere. Isn't that interesting? The real place for God's dwelling place is not the temple. And you folks need to see that, by the way, he's saying. God has said it's not a temple. It's not. That's not what's so important. Here's this text from Isaiah 66. Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where then is a house that you could build for me? And where is a place that I may rest? For my hand made these things, thus all these things came into being, declares the Lord. I made all the stuff that you're going to be using to build this temple, and I don't need a temple. I don't need a place like that. But again, it's going to be a special place. The Jews never actually taught that God lived in the temple. It's interesting. They don't teach that. But they have a feeling that that's his presence. That's the name is there. His presence is there. And so they have this special remembrance of the place. Neither the temple nor the tabernacle prevent God's further activity as he plans for his people. And so he'll do it. You men who are stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart, ears always resisting the Holy Spirit, you are doing just as your fathers did. Which one of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? They killed those who had previously announced the coming of the righteous one, whose betrayers and murderers you now have become. You who received the law as ordained by angels, and yet you did not keep it. Stephen's indictment of his listeners is pretty strong in verses 51 through 53. He's dealt with the history of Israel and their sin and their rebellion and their rejection of God and his purposes. And that's ultimately going to lead them into Babylonian captivity, but God's still going to be with them even there. God is with them. He describes them as stiff-necked. Interesting description, isn't it? They can't even turn their head. God's description of Israel's rebellion against Moses and the golden calf in Exodus chapter 33, verse 5, and Deuteronomy 9:13 follows that same pattern. They'll be described as uncircumcised in heart, Leviticus 26:41, Deuteronomy 10:16, Jeremiah 4:4, and Jeremiah 9:26. And so, again, the language he's using here is good Old Testament language. Our man Stephen knows his Old Testament, and he's playing off of that language. Stephen is speaking very much like one of the Old Testament prophets. In a very real way, he's like the prophets of the Old Testament, and he's predicting what God is saying is going to happen. Israel's persecution and killing of the prophets was indeed the case, and he ends with men, brothers, fathers. That's just as he began his little sermon, and so you see it there. Your fathers always rejected the Holy Spirit. Your fathers persecuted the prophets. You received the law through angels, and you did not obey it. You obeyed it. It was not obeyed by you. Stephen points his finger at them and sort of shaking his finger and saying, you're just like those folks. You've done just like they did, and so there is no real difference. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the quick and began gnashing their teeth at him. Now, we've seen that kind of language used more than once. It was used by the folks who want to kill the apostles earlier from the Sanhedrin, and now they're cut to the quick, and it's not like cut to the quick at the beginning of the book, at the end of the sermon on the day of Pentecost, where they're cut to the quick and they feel guilty and sorry for the way they've behaved. It's not that at all. But being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed intently into heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, behold, I see the heavens opened up and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But he cried out with a loud voice and covered their ears and rushed at him with one impulse. When they had driven him out of the city, they began stoning him. And the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they went on stoning Stephen as he called on the name of the Lord and said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And having said this, he fell asleep. Interesting language, isn't it? I love this part of the story. As you remember, the stoning of Stephen. Stephen is going to be the first, and he's sort of an apprentice among the Sanhedrin. He is preparing to be one of the great leaders of Israel. And I think that's important for us to see. And so they begin stoning him, and notice his language. He'll say, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. It's interestingly enough, a prayer offered to Jesus. Receive my spirit. And then the very end of it, he will say, Lord, don't hold this sin against them. What they're doing, they don't know. They don't understand it. And I like the language at the end. And he fell asleep. He dies, but he falls asleep. Rather noble way to talk about the death of this great man, this great hero in the faith. So you see what he's done in his sermon. He's worked his way through, and he's dealt with all of their accusations. The land. Well, the land is not as important as you think because God is with them wherever they are. It was in Mesopotamia. It was in Haran. It was in the Promised Land. It was in Egypt. It was off when they go to Babylon. God's with them wherever they are. And God being with them is what matters. And it isn't the law that's so important. The law is given by Moses, but you folks didn't even keep the law. And then, it's not the temple that's so important because God himself said, I don't need a temple. And they hear all of this, and you can see how he's really addressed their accusations in his sermon. And it angers them, to say the least. And they're ready to stone him, and so they do stone him, and he will die. What a wonderful language. What a wonderful story. So, we now have this wonderful stoning of our man Stephen. Let's pray as we close this morning. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for your son and for this wonderful story of your son that our man Stephen gives us. We thank you for his sermon and for what it really says about the history of your people. We're grateful to learn that story and be reminded of that wonderful story of your people. We pray that you'd be with us, Lord, and help us not to be like those folks who will minimize the significance of Jesus. And may we see how important he really is and how he's paved the way for us. Be with us this day. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.